So we thought we would do this by the report back. We can do it by the groups, right? by the themes, by the opportunities, constraints and solutions. So we can have one group present their opportunities first, the other group can add theirs, right, so we don't repeat, and we can do the same for constraints, and then we can conclude with the solutions, which in our program is the one-liner called agenda setting. So you'll get the subplot there was to arrive at a point where we've got some actionable solutions to work on collectively going forward. So can I, you know, randomly turn to group two, because they look so proud of that photograph. And Kiko, looks like you have the microphone in your hand. So would you like to take us through your opportunities? Then I'll ask group one to add any additional ones that were not covered by Kiko. Thanks.
Okay, the women in our group led the discussion, and I'm the slave, so I just report. So we grouped together the opportunities, and the first is that there are already existing resources, programs, and expertise that can be tapped and shared. Secondly, there is the availability of data, open data. There are also research results. And third, there are existing performance incentives for local governments. So that will enable them to open up. Number four, there are also incentives for HEIs in terms of budget support from CHED or DOST, as well as recognition of best in teaching, best in research, best in community engagement. Now we turn to constraints.
I'm going to stop you there, because we're going to do the opportunities. Do you want to give us a little bit more of a flavor of your, because you had four quick ones there, but do you want to give us a little bit more of a flavor of some of the detail?
Okay, with respect to resources, there are human and material resources already existing in individual HEIs. For example, there are also HEIs that already engage in local development councils, regional development councils. There are HEIs that are already doing public services. So there are engaged HEIs, but then they tend to operate individually. Number two, there is available data. In terms of the open data policy, the local government, there is the full disclosure policy. That's part of the Seal of Good Housekeeping and later on Seal of Good Local Governance. So there is data that can be used by researchers, by HEIs, also by CSOs to monitor government performance. Of course, the other question is to validate the data that is presented. With respect to performance grants, it can incentivize local governments to open up, to provide data, and to be transparent, because that's part of the what we now call the Seal of Good Local Governance, that will enable you to be qualified to ask for additional funds from the national government. On the part of HEIs, there are publication incentives. So if you do research, and if you go by Dr. Noel Dijo's suggestion, more actual research on local poverty situations.
Thank you. Group one, who is your, have you got a spokesperson?
They left the microphone on my okay. I am doing
There's
this
a hint.
Under protest. We were joined by one lady, but most of us were laggers, we were lagging behind in education. Other boys, so they tried to overdo this afternoon. Opportunities, we recognize that the regional development councils would provide a good good opportunity to do the planning and maybe even have a budget portion under their direction. There will be some problems with that too, but let me just focus on opportunities. We were very hopeful and identified that Congress has a rich opportunity for coordination given the national scope and their link up. There are also many problems, but I'll keep to the positive side for the time. societal engagements of AGIs on at least two areas. One is obviously the research, which is very much a part of what they are supposed to be doing. And number two, the service learning, which is actually provides them not only with the budget, but also with the personnel to engage the local community. In some universities, that has borne fruit into something beyond the term as institutional societal engagement, so that it's not a one-time thing and can actually be a problem-based extension of the university. All of which are not an appendix to the university, but part and parcel of its mission. The opportunity to make local development planning process more participatory. I also had the impression that many universities are actually already doing that. So that's not something new. I'll discuss the reservations later. HEIs are happy to assist the local government in local planning, whether that's in the whether that's in the participatory or in actual provision of data and evidence for their thinking process, as well as facilitators and maybe eventually technical assistance to them. Someone even mentioned putting up a portal where transparency can be an aspect of local governance and hosted by a university. And then the development plan, Philippine development plan, is clearer now as to how planning and budgeting should happen, and therefore that could be a guide for many of the universities.
Thank you. While you're standing, do you want to cover your constraints as well? Not.
We have more constraints than opportunities. I belong to a revolutionary group that critique everything wrong about the bureaucracy and the government. One, beginning with the RTCs could actually present the opportunity both for budget as well as clear agenda for research. But if they have the money, then you could also have a very politicized way, and therefore the HEIs may not have the independence required for that. Politicians always meddle with the research, so that may put the research itself and its data and conclusions in question if you put it directly under them. While there's a lot of participatory planning, and even if the universities help, the big question is, are the LGUs all the way to the barangay level, are they really capable of doing the planning? And thus the role of the university may be to actually capacitate the different levels of governance so they can do the planning. Secondly, provide them with actual data so that the discussions are not just anecdotal, but based on what you have hard evidence, as hard evidence. There is a distinction between private HEIs and SUCs, with SUCs receiving a lot of the pressure, both from the wise congressman and the local government CEOs, and the need to kind of provide the distance as well as the independence for the SUCs, especially. Apparently, the RDCs don't have the budget for research. I don't think the national government has a substantial amount for research at the same time. There was mention of DOST type of research funding, but also a question of whether should all the research, especially on poverty, just be on the science aspect of it. There is also a big sense that there is a lot of research already available. And maybe on the opportunity side, maybe somebody can just make available the inventory of all the research, including current research. Even if they're not yet done, at least people could contact them. But the bigger constraint is actually translating the research conclusions into actual either policies or implemented as projects. The group actually felt that this is the bigger challenge, rather than duplicating many of the research that has already been done and translating that into policy recommendations.
Thank you. Pico, would you like to add?
Okay, the way we did it was to line up the opportunities and constraints. So while we identify that there are opportunities in terms of existing resources, the constraint is that these resources are still inadequate. And in terms of funding as well as available facilities, at the same time, while it is recognized that there is expertise, there's still capacity gaps, especially in engaging local governments. On the HEI side, the question of teaching overload. So I think it relates to Novendijo's observation that the need to align with the key responsibilities of the teaching and primary teaching. So there is a need to allocate time for research and community engagement. Well, data is available. The data that is out there may need to be disaggregated, so putting it in the proper scale, as well as the data being available in a timely manner to enhance its usefulness. So it's the quality of the data that can be the constraint, as well as the scale. With respect to performance, we identified as an opportunity the enhanced performance at different levels, there is still observation that there's poor local governance and the existence of corruption, traditional politics, as well as still questions of transparency and lack of trust. And the other aspect of governance is the lack of coordination and perhaps different lenses being used, national, local. So perhaps the challenge is how coordination can be done vertically as well as horizontally, looking at the entire ecosystem.
Yes.
And lastly, the lack of appreciation for the results from the partnership. So perhaps it's the appreciation of evidence-based results or evidence-based research that feeds into policy. Okay, perhaps it's really like making the outputs really useful. And maybe because the tendency is for certain outputs to be just shelving or filed but not published.
Do you want to move to your solution?
Okay.
Yeah.
So in terms of the solution, more funding. certainly that's the
okay, seriously.
So can I sit down? Now I mentioned, the group mentioned the tendency for the different institutions, agencies, organizations to operate in silos. So there is a need, perhaps, to have a functional consortium of HEIs and development agencies. So perhaps the budget and resources can be much more leveraged. National local HEI partnerships. So Imperial Manila partnering with the Imperial Davao. No, but I think that could be a very fruitful partnership if local knowledge can really be leveraged and used and mainstream at the national level. Because in a side conversation with Bong, we were talking about I told that I'm interested in integrating peace the products from peace research, and I was given the reply that has been done at the local level, but Imperial Manila should learn from what's been done at the local level. But I think that kind of knowledge exchange would be very mutually beneficial. And then there's data available. There's need to interrogate the quality of the data. That's a constraint. And the solution is to undertake people-centered research, or what Noel did just mention as problem focus on problem solving. So that can be addressed as well by including an action research funding facility. I think I connected this with having a consortium of local policy laboratories, taking off from the example in MIT that there is a policy lab or a poverty action lab. So the pursuit of research, local poverty research, would be much more fruitful if you group together, come up with a multidisciplinary team of anti-poverty researchers. And that can be promoted by having local policy laboratories. I think to also address the issue of the lack of evidence-based policy development, both at the local development council decision making and also at local council decisions in terms of ordinances. Then create non-troubled politicians. And having a permanent local bureaucracy, career officials at the local government level. So this would therefore address yung performance, no? Performance, what you can do, merit, rather than who you know or who you are related with. Finally, improve incentive schemes, both for HEI, so perhaps promoting action research, valuing those types of pursuits in HEI as equivalent to teaching, so finding that balance. And incentive schemes also for local governments. So perhaps more performance transfers, or performance fiscal transfers. Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Kiko. Brother.
We have actually our proposal is truthfully to amend the procurement law to abolish Congress and establish a revolutionary government. But our censored version is this for the solution. I'm serious, that was the real sentiment of the group. To create a council of HEIs on a national level, that includes both SUCs and private, which is critical because we feel that that network will be the integrator for local planning, while it is a template for national. It farms out on an area-based research to the different universities on the ground. It becomes, in effect, the brain trust for LGUs, so that, but I think beyond LGUs, on any group, NGO, that wish to look at the face of poverty and present solutions by way of action research. And then, but in terms of policy, they can also present to the different government agencies the results of their action research so that they can submit actual plans or programs. They can be the link and the connection to a national network or coalition, which can develop the knowledge development center network, so that you have a repository of that, which can easily be scaled up. So the challenge again is how do you scale that up and replicate in other areas? It is possible even for the corrupt RDC to partner with the saintly HEI, so that the independence provides the RDC with the push for programs that could actually be sustainable. The HEIs are happy to build the capacity of the LGUs for their local planning rather than dictate to them what they should be doing. And that network can also be the template for extension services and research. If pulled together, that becomes your national database. Big data that can allow you to look at maps, overlap the different data sets, and then come up with a science-based, evidence-based program that will actually be helpful for all those who are engaged in implementation. We recognize that the HEIs with those twin role of action research as well as high power research and database cannot be the implementer of those programs. At best, we pilot test the programs, come up with prototypes, and recommend policies for those who are supposed to do the implementation themselves. There is also need to do the dissemination of the data beyond what the research already captures, and the need for all HEIs to come together with respect to a common research agenda that's big enough so that it attracts funding and can also be used as leverage to the very corrupt politicians whose names we will keep secret. I think the rest are. But we went a step further rather than provide a solution. We actually have a framework and an organizational chart. And in fact, we are appointing a retired chairman by June 1. So I will stop here and ask Ben, our new appointee, to explain his. Please welcome our chairman of the.
Well, after listening to everything this morning and our discussion here this afternoon, we just thought that we have to have a local face of poverty. Throughout the country, there are different faces of poverty, and we need to understand the local face of poverty, where you are. And program interventions have to be tailored according to that local face of poverty. And it has to be delivered by some kind of an action agency, whether it's local government, national government, or NGOs. But there has to be a very clear set of action agencies to deliver the program interventions for that particular phase of poverty in the different parts of the country. The role of HEI is merely to act like some kind of a brain trust. It's an assisting brain trust organization. The role of HEI is first and foremost to undertake very clear action research on that local face of poverty. And it must be a continuous process. And this will develop the basis for policy, research, and recommendations for the implementing agencies. So the agencies will use the policy and research-based recommendations of the HEIs to tailor and share program interventions without respect to that face of poverty. Now, if that face of poverty is the basis of your action research, on the basis of your policy recommendations, then this cycle will, in the words of government, synergize into a more improving solution.
Towards the end of the program today, so just from my side and the side of the teams who've organized this from the UNDP and PIDS side, we'd like to thank you all for coming and all of you actively contributing to the discussion, the debates. I'm glad we've had a few of those, and I'm sure they'll continue. So to wrap up the program for today, I'm going to turn over to boss and the UNDP country director here for the Philippines, Tito Mitra.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for all your participation throughout the day. I mean, for me, it's always a great honor when I sort of sit in a room full of such eminent thinkers. I have to say, brother, I mean, this was a live broadcast, so my apologies. I probably should have told you that before you did your wrap-up. But on a very serious note, this notion of leave no one behind, it's such a compelling issue, and I'm so glad that so many people are focusing on it, because it has a very interesting dimension, and it only really struck me last night when I was thinking about this session, is that it's not necessarily just about identifying who are being left behind, and it's not even about getting those that we've identified above a particular line. But the really interesting part about leaving no one behind is to make sure that the gap is one that closes and closes very, very quickly. And I think that presents a whole lot of challenges. You know, how do we measure the rate of progress? And I haven't heard a lot of ideas in the public discourse yet on that issue, because I think at the moment we're still fixated on the first point, which is, you know, how do we identify those who have to be left behind? The other point I want to make is that, you know, it's in terms of what we're measuring, it's not really just about the changes in the number and status of those left behind. But I think the challenge for us also is to start to think about measuring the process of inclusion. I mean, that's a qualitative assessment that we really have to look at. And the other aspect, which is a little bit politically loaded, is the institutional performance. You know, that at the end of the day, you know, when you're combating poverty, it's institutions do matter. And this is where I think HEIs play such a critical role. You can be the credible, independent voice on the quality of government institutions and hold governments to account. And there's a lot of discussion about data, and I think another challenge we have to think about is that, and Toby sort of mentioned this, she's not here, that, you know, we can get caught up in the pursuit of perfect data, but you know, what are the bellwether indicators that really allow us to pick a set of operable indicators that we can focus on that gives us a quick measure in terms of how we're performing against this progress of leaving no one behind? So, I mean, there are many issues that you discussed, but the bottom line here is really, how do we bring HEIs into the process in a more systematic way? And I kind of like very happy to hear what I thought were three very tangible recommendations. One is this creation of a council or a consortium of HEIs, which can help facilitate both vertical and horizontal linkages. The second one is this notion of localized poverty action labs. I mean, all of us talk about prototyping and then moving to scale, but I think someone also mentioned that it's important that scale isn't a generic thing, that it has to be translated into local relevance, and this is why localized poverty action labs seem like a great option to bring in RDCs and HEIs and private sector. sector and CSOs. And we, UNDP actually has a model of this somewhat in the governance hubs that we've been creating across the country. I think there's 11 or 12 at the moment, which is a partnership between education institutions, private sector and civil society to support local governments in the implementation of their programs, and this can be built upon. And then the third issue is the knowledge platforms. There is a wealth of research out there, but the accessibility of the research, not just of the data, and translating that into something usable for local governments particularly has always been a challenge. So there is an agenda. But my question to you is that, you know, it's great to hold these conversations, but UNDP certainly would like to have an ongoing partnership in this. Do you think there is a role for UNDP? And I was thinking, Madam President of PIDS, that we, you know, there is an opportunity to partner with PIDS to create the impetus for this consortium. So if there is some sort of endorsement from all of you as representatives of various AGIs, then we really would like to take that forward. So maybe we can have a follow-up discussion on how we might reconvene and start to put in place some of these institutional structures. Ultimately, the purpose here is to make people understand better what the notion of leaving no one behind is, and then create the accountability for those who should be delivering the services. So again, thank you very much for the opportunity to listen to at least some part of your conversation. And with your agreement, we certainly would like to see if we can take this forward with some of those actionable items that were mentioned. Thank you again.